This is the D&I Moment workshop. You'll be hearing from myself, Megan, Miriam, and Joy today. And then we will have a breakout session after our brief introduction. So from there, I think Megan is going to start us off.
Hi folks, my name is Megan. I use pronouns like she and her, and I'm an undergraduate in the chemistry department. And before we start to get into what our D&I moments are, we want to give you a little bit of how, as an alliance, we thought of this, how we came to having an entire workshop for this. So as someone in the chemistry department, we have these things called safety moments. They're in other departments too. And something unique to our department is we have the joint safety team with the chemical engineering department. And between our departments, we have this whole collection of what are we call safety moments, which are just 1 to 2 slides of information about how to be safe in lab, in research, in our workplaces. So I included an example here of one that we have on common laboratory injuries. So, you know, on the first slide on the left, it talks about that most people believe that their labs were safe, yet about half experienced injuries in their lab space. And then on the right, as the second slide, and it gives some examples of some what these injuries are and some conversation questions. So we really wanted to take this. So these safety moments, this is how we start all of our group meetings, all of our research meetings, even, you know, our large department meetings, we'll even start with these safety moments. And so we really wanted to take this and see how we can apply it to what we're calling a D&I moment. Next slide, please. So our vision for the D&I moments was that this, like safety moments within our departments, these were gonna be at the start of every meeting, every class, every gathering here in the college. We're taking a few moments to talk about a concept, a event, a person, something related to diversity, equity, and inclusion work. And that we, the goal truly is every meeting, when you're having your department staff meeting, you're starting with one of these, when you're starting a class, you know, I personally would love to see you start every lecture with these moments. That I can understand if maybe you're starting just the class for the semester with one of these, right? When we're having gatherings as for celebratory events, when folks get tenure and things like that, you know, bringing this in. And the goal really here is to, like the way a safety moment normalizes the conversation regarding lab safety, this is to normalize having DEI conversations in all the spaces that we occupy and making this normal. And most importantly, this is a great opportunity for all of us to learn and grow as scientists, engineers, and most importantly, allies. So we're talking about exposing people to scientists and engineers who have done great things, but, you know, aren't included in the history books. We're talking about really defining moments in our collective history that we don't talk about. We're talking about events, holidays, concepts, things that folks might not know about. And in this, we're all gonna grow and learn together. So with that, I'm very happy to let Miriam take it away and explain how we go about making these D&I moments.
Thanks, Megan. For those of you who don't know me already, I'm Miriam Krause. I'm the Director of Education Outreach and Diversity for the Center for Sustainable Nanotechnology, which is a chemistry center for chemical innovation funded by the NSF. And we, about 5 years ago, actually started doing what we call DISC moments, which is a rotating set of moments at the beginning of all of our weekly center-wide meetings. And the D in DISC stands for diversity in that case. And so about once a month for the last 5 years, we've done one of these moments at our center-wide meeting. And in our experience in doing this has been overall really, really positive. And so I'm very happy to be sharing that, some of that with all of you today. So when you're creating D&I moments, the guidelines that we've found to work best are to keep it really, really short, 1 to 3 minutes. You're not trying to explain an entire concept or tell all the information about something. That would be impossible. People do spend entire lectures or semesters or doctoral dissertations talking about some of these topics. So you're just gonna do a 1 to 3 minute introduction. And the goal is really to spark curiosity, to encourage people to find out more, to have more conversations, to seek out more resources about these things. And as Megan said, to get people more comfortable just talking about them, just having it be part of the everyday conversation. And when creating them, it's really important to think about both the speaker, meaning if you're the one who's presenting it, what is in your, what's your perspective? What's in your sort of purview? You don't have to be an expert, but there are topics where it could be more or less appropriate for you to be the one who is introducing that concept. And with kind of an infinite realm of options, picking something that is in your wheelhouse is something that you should strive to do. And then also thinking about your audience. What do you know about their comfort level with the topics you're considering, with their pre-existing knowledge? In some audiences, simply talking about what does D&I stand for? Why do we have diversity and inclusion? That could be a moment for some audiences. For others, you may be confident that they're all kind of already on board with that and you can pick something else, just as an example. Next slide, please. So as I said, there's kind of infinite options for what you might think about in doing a D&I moment. And one way, if you're kind of feeling overwhelmed with the choice and you're trying to decide what to talk about, you can browse through previous moments. We're gonna show you a whole bunch of examples today just to kind of get the creative juices flowing. And we hope to have in the not too distant future, a college-wide sort of repository of moments that have been presented before. So like with the safety moments that Megan was discussing, you could borrow one of those slides if it seems to suit your purpose and use it, or just browsing through what other people have talked about could give you an idea for something that you would like to present. You can look through social media, national organizations, meaning, for example, the American Chemical Society is one that, you know, for chemistry that we refer to, will have resources and things about diversity and inclusion that might spark some ideas. Resource lists that can either, the list itself could be something that you would want to share with your audience, or one of the resources that you find could be something to share. So, and the nice thing is, because the idea is that we're going to do a lot of these, hopefully the pressure is low that you don't have to be creating the perfect moment. You're creating one piece of something that is going to be like a giant tapestry of the experiences or the information that people are going to be getting across many different meetings. So you don't have to make the one best D&I moment ever. You just have to do one good one that you are excited to share. So there are many, many good possibilities. And what you're going to be doing, again, as Megan alluded to this, there's a million different things you could do. You could inform your audience about an historical or contemporary figure, a historical event, an upcoming learning opportunity, some vocabulary term, resources that you find or recommend. You could introduce or review a particular research article, a book or a film, and it could be something where you are literally reviewing it, you know, recommending it or not recommending it, or it could be something where you haven't read the whole thing yet, but you are you encountered it and you're intrigued by it. And again, you want to spark conversation or encourage people to seek out more information. So we can pause for a second, I think, if there are questions right now. Otherwise, I think we're going to dive into some of our examples. Great. All right. So I think our plan is to do three or four full. So the first one is mine. An example of actually what we would deliver for the moment. And then we have another half a dozen or so that we were just going to kind of skim through and again, to give you the idea of the breadth of the sort of topics we're talking about. So this one is called Grounding Assumptions for DEI Conversations. And this is one that I did right at the beginning of our experience with the CSN. And I think it's a really nice one to do early in your kind of, if in your group's experience with these things, because it reminds people about kind of founding principles or grounding assumptions, hence the name. So the three points here are that the work of equity and diversity is about creating community, which involves building trust through careful listening, respectful disagreement, and taking risks. Growth and learning can be uncomfortable, and it's okay. In fact, you could argue that the goal of many of these is to be a little bit uncomfortable if it's something that's new to you and causing you to think and maybe reconsider. And it is okay to make mistakes because we all do. And the avoidance of mistakes, in fact, is something that can be really problematic. If you don't talk about something because you don't want to make a mistake, that's not a good thing. And then individuals and organizations can and do grow and change. That's part of why we're doing this, but it doesn't happen overnight. It's going to be gradual. And this slide, I just did that in whatever that was, about a minute. And then we would pause and ask for a conversation, you know, for a couple of minutes again. But it's meant to be food for thought. And this is an example of a slide where I basically read the slide to you, which usually is not good practice necessarily for a presentation. But in this case, I think it served the purpose. It doesn't have any fancy pictures. I, of course, put the citation of where I got this material from. And I might say, like, in fact, I have said, you know, I got this from one of the OED, University of Minnesota OED workshop sessions that I've attended, and I thought it set a really nice tone for that workshop, and that's why I'm presenting it here. So adding a little bit about, you know, why you wanted to do that. So it can be very, very simple like this. I think, I don't know, any comments or questions about that one? Thanks, Rhonda. Okay, I think we can do the next one, which I believe is Joy's.
Oh, I think it's mine.
Sorry, go ahead.
Okay, so this one is called Respecting Names. And just a little bit of history about names. European colonizers attacked and defiled African names and naming systems to suppress and erase African identities. So it's really important that people tell you their preferred name, that you use it. Things you should never say are, can I just call you blank instead? This is disrespectful because you are disregarding an entire person's history and an identity by giving them a different name. There's also an uncomfortable power dynamic with that. An equally inappropriate thing to do is to tap the person on their shoulder because you'd rather not get their name wrong. If you can't remember someone's name, you can just tell them that. Just be honest and politely say, forgive me, could you remind me how to say your name? And if they've given you their name before, the second time, it's good for you to jot it down in your notepad just so you can remind yourself and remember in the future. If you're someone who has a name that's frequently pronounced wrong, you should feel empowered to tell people. Just to let you know, you're pronouncing my name incorrectly. It's pronounced however you pronounce it, and you can repeat that. And on the University of Minnesota campus, we're very fortunate because there is a free service called Name Coach for all instructors, professors, TAs. You can request that your students say their names, and there's a recording of it, and that's available to you as well as all of your the classmates in that class. They can review people's name pronunciation there.
Alrighty, so my D&I moment is introducing Dr. Cynthia Vernon. She joined NASA as a mathematician when she graduated from college. Her experience as an African-American woman working as a mathematician at NASA in the early 1960s, quietly making significant contributions, went unrecognized until just recently. Not sure if you all are familiar with the movie Hidden Figures, starring Taraji P. Henson. Dr. Vernon was actually one of those hidden figures that worked tirelessly to put some of the first men, US men, on the moon. And there is a video. For the sake of time, we're not going to show it, but this particular D&I moment is very special to me because it is my good friend's mother. And this particular D&I moment obviously is showcasing a historical figure connected to a movie, but it's a really powerful one just because this individual is still living. But when you hear her own story, those words are impactful. So there definitely can be discussion around it. You can bring in obviously the Hollywood factor, and then also just the fact that it is an individual still walking the earth. So that is that one. A second D&I moment is a website that's designed to support individuals and groups working to achieve racial equity. So it's racialequitytools.com. The site offers resources such as research tips, curricula, and ideas. The one thing that I'd like to highlight, especially because of my job, part of my role as the HR director is to provide resources for folks. There's a glossary that this website features, and it is a glossary of terms, which I like to think of as something that can ground everybody as you begin either putting together a D&I team within your department, or you're starting to work on a project. This glossary just really helps you define or helps you look at the various terms that are used in racial equity work. So discrimination, anti-racism, racism, what does everything mean, so that you and your group can get together and have a working knowledge of what it is that you are trying to do. And so Lindsay just put in the chat the website, which is also included here on the slide, but again, to promote discussion, to actually have a base document that you and your team can move forward with and everybody's on the same page.
Now I think we're just going to give you a few more examples. This is another example of a historical figure. And Gladys West, she was a mathematician, so there's that.
This is an example of sharing resources, and it was just something that I was thinking about during Black History Month last February, and Black in STEM and Black History Month were sort of trending on Twitter a lot, and so I created this one as a kind of timely moment at that time. This is an example of reporting or sharing information from a research article. This is another, that's my fault. I left off the citation on this one. Be careful about that. But this was another basically sharing terminology or a concept about social class transitions and why folks who move from one social class to another, and Black in the Ivory, yes, thank you, Kara, moving from one social class to another impacts the individual and the groups that they're part of. This is a fun one, kind of a conceptual thing. Why do we talk about power and what superheroes can teach us about power? So it's making these concepts accessible to folks who are familiar with superheroes and what those stories have to say about power. This is a really nice one about invisible disabilities, and I did not, I didn't have time to reformat it for the D&I, the CSE D&I moment format, but I actually, it's nice to make the point that, you know, you don't have to stick to our little template if you don't want to. There can be opportunities to expand on that as well. And I think there's just one more. Yep, this is another one where kind of not as pretty, but again, really some really important information about accessibility in academic conferences. And this is someone where she pulled information from a couple of different sources and synthesized them into one diagram for the DISC moment.